Simon & Schuster Audio presents War and Punishment, Putin, Zelensky, and the Path to Russia's Invasion of Ukraine, by Mikhail Zygar, read by Richard Attlee.
Introduction. This book is a confession. I am guilty for not reading the signs much earlier. I too am responsible for Russia's war against Ukraine, as are my contemporaries and our forebears. Regrettably, Russian culture is also to blame for making all these horrors possible. Many Russian writers and historians are complicit in facilitating this war. It is their words and thoughts over the past 350 years that sowed the seeds of Russian fascism and allowed it to flourish, although many would be horrified today to see the fruits of their labour. We fail to spot just how deadly the very idea of Russia as a great empire was. Of course, any empire is evil, but let different historians judge other empires. We overlook the fact that, for many centuries, great Russian culture belittled other countries and peoples, suppressed and destroyed them. So that Russian culture may live on, we must act. We must start by looking inside ourselves and telling the truth about our past and our present. Russian, Ukrainian, and indeed any history is made up of myths. Alas, our myths led us to the fascism of 2022. It is time to expose them. This book is about myths and about people. People who lived 100, 200, 300 years ago and then turned into mythological figures. They died physically. Then historians stripped away their human qualities, their weaknesses, their passions, their doubts, their true motives. They were subjected to the inexorable logic of history, which serves the needs of those in power. This book also tells about our contemporaries, such as Volodymyr Zelensky. He and many others appear real and noble to us now, yet soon they, too, will become immortalized and heroized, and in a generation will seem like legendary characters. Moreover, one of the protagonists of this book, Putin, has already, in his lifetime, turned into an otherworldly, universal evil, and I try to trace how this happened. I specifically wrote this book in modern language and the present tense, trying to convey and clarify historical terms, drawing present-day parallels, so that today's reader might grasp the spirit, not merely the letter. I would like this book to be understandable to readers a century from now, to give them a glimpse into our thought processes. For this purpose, I have tried to depict all the characters as living people, not historical monuments, and to debunk the old myths without sparing historians, without pity for yesterday's idols, without being afraid to offend the feelings of fellow Russians. This book will not undo the past and present, but it can change the future. Nationalist history is a disease that afflicts many peoples. The Russian people can stamp out the myths that have infected them. The Ukrainian people will deal with theirs on their own. For many years, starting in 2004, I visited Ukraine as a journalist. During this time, I got to interview every Ukrainian president and make the acquaintance of most politicians, big businessmen, well-known reporters, and even clergymen. I witnessed many events, from the talks between Presidents Leonid Kuchma and Vladimir Putin back in 2003, to the opening of the Babin Yar Memorial by President Volodymyr Zelensky in 2021, which commemorates the site where Nazis killed thousands of Jews. Sometimes I spent lengthy periods in Kyiv and the surrounding region. For example, in Bucha, at the house of my friend Nadia, I wrote a significant portion of my book, All the Kremlin's Men. Incidentally, Nadia no longer speaks to me. Because I am Russian, she considers me an imperialist. Recent decades have seen me working as a political journalist in Russia, trying to uncover the hidden causes and motives behind events. I have followed the ever-changing Russian policy in respect to Ukraine. Often horrified by what I heard, I never concealed my thoughts as an opposition journalist and writer. In 2010, I was one of the founders of the TV station Dozhd, Rain, the only independent news channel in Russia. In 2014, it was effectively shut down for its honest, detailed coverage of the revolution of dignity in Ukraine, when the Ukrainian government was overthrown by Ukrainians tired of corruption and abuse of power. A month before the occupation of Crimea, the Kremlin ordered all Russian cable and satellite networks to switch off TV Rain. I remember well how on March 1, 2014, Russian senators authorized the president to use the Russian armed forces outside the country. That is, gave a green light to war in Ukraine. That day, as the station's editor-in-chief, I wrote a letter to my colleague saying that from now on we should always write in Ukraine, even if it jars the ears of Russian grammarians, as a sign of respect and support for independent Ukraine. Before that, for many years, Russians have traditionally said «на Україні», «on Ukraine», instead of «в Україні», «in Ukraine». Ukrainians usually considered it insulting, as the preposition «on» makes Ukraine sound like a territory, not a country. A similar distinction exists in English, where «Ukraine» has largely replaced «the Ukraine». But in March 2014, that became crystal clear for me. If it's important for Ukrainians, we must take heed. On February 24, 2022, when Putin launched a full-scale invasion of Ukraine, I wrote an open letter that was signed by several Russian writers, filmmakers, and journalists. Later, tens of thousands more Russian citizens put their signatures to it. Here it is. The war launched by Russia against Ukraine is shameful. It is our shame, but unfortunately, our children, as well as generations of still infant and unborn Russians, will also have to bear responsibility for it. We do not want our children to live in an aggressor country, to be ashamed that their army attacked a neighboring independent state. We call upon all citizens of Russia to say no to this war. We do not believe that an independent Ukraine poses a threat to Russia or any other state. We do not believe in Vladimir Putin's statements that the Ukrainian people are ruled by Nazis and must be liberated. We demand an end to this war. Then I had to flee to Germany. During my first year of living in Berlin, I reviewed all the previous interviews I'd conducted over the past 18 years of working in Ukraine and in Russia. And I kept talking to people, hundreds of people. And they recalled what had brought us to where we are now. From these conversations, old and new, this book was born. But there are two parts. This book is not only about the present, but also about the past. About the historical myths from which today's politics has grown and which it is founded upon. I carefully and impartially read the historical sources and tried to trace the origins and development of the brutal Russian Empire that gave rise to the current war. This book is by no means an attempt to write the history of Ukraine. Rather, it is a detective story through the eyes of the criminal. A chronicle of how Russia has oppressed Ukraine for the past five centuries. How the empire tried to bring up the loyal elite, but in the end couldn't have suppressed Ukrainian society. This book tells about the long road to war, and about the road to punishment that we have yet to travel. Nadia, I am not an imperialist, and I am writing this book so that others will not be either. Part 1. Seven Tales of Colonial Oppression in Ukraine. Chapter 1. The Myth of Unity. How Bohdan Khmelnytsky signed a contract with Moscow. Inventing the Russian World. 1670. Kyiv. A German monk is writing a history book. He is Innocenti Giesel, a native of Königsberg, who grew up in a Protestant family.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.